I join Bruce in thanking the Academy, Leslie and Paul Karoff and the staff there, and in expressing my gratitude at the opportunity to work on this project. I'm just going to say a very few things. We'll have a Q&A. This is not the time to try to run through the numbers. And in any case, Bruce is the numbers guy in our team. You have the issue in front of you, the challenge of mass incarceration. So I want to talk a little bit about the challenge, which is to say I want to talk about the normative questions, the questions of justice, the value questions that are at stake here. Whenever I show this graph that plots the incarceration rate per 100,000 persons in the country across time, and you get to the early 1970s and that curve starts trending up almost like an exponential and it looks like it's just shooting through the roof, audiences gasp. You know, it's a really shocking thing, the institutional transformation that's happened in the country over this period of time. What is that saying about us and about our democracy? Okay, so one way of answering that question, the normative question, what are the values that are at play here? What is the challenge of mass incarceration consist in? We talk about reform. Why is there an urgency for reform? Okay. One thing that's raised by all of that is this issue of, well, people have broken the law and they're being punished. What we're looking at is the outcome of the application of legitimate law, the state, the monopoly over the legitimate use of violence, the police securing public safety, the laws arrived at through democratic process. If people didn't break the law, they wouldn't be in this fix, okay? So what we have here is the perhaps lamentable but necessary consequence of order maintenance, which is an imperative of the government, of the state, securing people in their person and in their property. I think that that's an extremely, I do personally, after the study of this issue and interaction with people and so on, an extremely thin read, an extremely inadequate argument of justification for what we do. By the way, it's us, we the people. This is a democratic implementation. This is a response to what we demand of our politicians. So now we have 7.5 million people under corrections, correctional supervision. We have 2.25 in prison at any point in time. We have historically unprecedented, internationally, comparatively unprecedented scope and scale of institution. We have a concentrated incidence of this legitimate deployment of state force, violence, coercion, corralling of people, dragging them into holding them under custody. Okay, unprecedented in the inequality of the incidence of it, the racial and the class inequality of the incidence. So what exactly is the imperative of reform here? Okay. Bruce mentions one point, I want to make three. What happens in San Quentin doesn't stay in San Quentin, that's the way I'd put it. Okay? You're taking people and you're dealing with them one-off cases, bad actors, they need to be punished, retribution, you know, incapacitation, we're holding them in custody, okay? And we've got these cases. Okay? But what happens in San Quentin doesn't stay in San Quentin. The institution of the prison is not on another planet somewhere. The populations involved are circulating back and forth between these communities and into these institutions, between these communities and into these institutions. There are consequences in these communities of the character of the institutions in which large numbers of the people who are resident in these communities are being confined. Okay? Todd Clear makes this point very forcefully in his book, Imprisoning Communities. We have an essay in the volume by Rob Sampson and Charles Leffler, if I get the name correct, who do a quantitative study of the spatial incidence of incarceration in the city of Chicago. Which is representative of what you see in many big cities, which is a highly concentrated and relatively few neighborhoods incidence of where the incarceration is taking place. Those people are getting off that bus when they're released from the institution and they're going back into those communities and there are consequences of that. So whatever one may have thought about the individual bad actor and the need to administer a retributive or a incapacitating punishment to the person for the act that they've undertaken, There will be consequences of having done so that spill over beyond that individual person, and that may actually be criminogenic. That is, they may actually end up promoting the very behaviors that we're trying to discourage. I'd say something else. A second point that I would make along this line of a qualitative discussion about the normative questions that are raised by our institutional practice that has now advanced to the extent that it has and has become so deeply entrenched. And that is that a million cases, each one perhaps rightly decided, can still add up to an historic wrong. I mean, once I was at a meeting of the National Academy of Sciences committee that deals with criminal justice issues that I've been serving on, and a police officer of a high rank from a major American city was present at the meeting in which, quote unquote, mass incarceration was being discussed. And the police officer said, I assume there's some degree of due process in these cases, which was making the point that you people are lamenting mass incarceration, but I'm telling you that people are having their day in court. They've had their day in their court and they've been convicted, so there's been due process. So what exactly is the wrong? And what I want to say is that this is not merely, and by the way, what I say here now is a matter of interpretation. I mean, there are different ways of seeing this thing. From the angle of vision that I want to promote, this is not merely one-off treatment of right or wrongful behavior in individual cases. This is also a political and an institutional response to manage the consequences of social dysfunction in our society that are a reflection in part of the failure of basic institutions of human development, which are leaving us with large numbers of incompletely developed people, damaged people, people who have real serious problems. They have problems of economic viability, they have problems of mental and physical health and emotional well-being, and the rest. We have scarred and damaged people in our midst. Okay? They act out, and we come down on them with a ton of bricks. We're managing our own institutional failures through coercive control over selected populations. I don't mean that there are names put on a list and then you go and find the person on the list. I just mean that there are pockets of a lack of opportunity, of backwardness and marginality in our society that throw off negative consequences. And we're responding that to that mainly with a punitive mobilization. Okay? Now, that's a statement about us. That is to say, about we the people of the United States. That is to say, about our collective political enterprise. Okay? We have choices about how we think about this. Can we muster a politics that would give voice to the full range of those choices? Right? Or are we only going to have a stick-figured politics, a black and white politics that looks for bad guys and then comes down on them with a ton of bricks? That's up to us. I'm told by people, including good friends and colleagues, Loury, you're a social scientist. Why are you wasting your time trying to be a moral philosopher? You're not very good at it. Okay? Stick to the numbers. Tell us about cause and effect, and it's somebody else's job to talk about values. Okay? I'm doing the best I can. I may not be very good at it, but I don't buy the premise that we have this division between the numbers on the one hand, the science and the sort of objective inquiry on the one hand, and the value premises on the other that motivate us to act and that allow us to make refined judgments about how we want to live together. I think those things are symbiotically connected with one another. I think one needs to be informed about the facts, but I think if one precludes a consideration of the questions of ought, one will be making a mistake. Finally, let me say this. The role of race in this circumstance that we're talking about in this issue, the huge racial disparity in the incidence of the application of punishment and incarceration and imprisonment in the country, profoundly important, and it's way beyond the question of civil rights. It's way beyond the question of the 14th Amendment. I've got nothing against the 14th Amendment. I think it's necessary to say that these days. Nothing whatsoever. But we're not just talking here about the equal protection of the laws. We're talking about institutional development, the rise of the hyper-incarceration state, embedded within a cultural and historical framework, which is dripping with racial pathology. Okay, the historians and the political scientists will probably be debating until the day I die whether or not this curve going upward in the early 1970s, as I was describing before, is a reflection somehow of a latent anti-black animus that was seized on by politicians and so on. There are books out there that are making that argument. I'm not taking a position one way or the other about it. But what I'm saying from a long historical view is, how can you look at the history of race, racial inequality, racial oppression, racial subordination in the United States of America, as it has played out over 250 years, look at the racial complexion of the persons who are subject to this extraordinary mobilization of public coercion on behalf of safety, and not see that there's some deep connection between those things. This does say something about us. Could I prove with econometric certitude that the racial component, you know, the claim would be, if most of those subjects to the depredations of the mass incarceration state were not black and brown, we wouldn't have gone quite so far down this road as we have gone. That's a claim. How could I prove that scientifically? I'd have difficulty doing so, but I certainly believe that it is the case. Now, that's my conviction, but for all of us, the question, the possibility, right? What is it saying about us as a nation, given our history, that we have this racialized public deployment of force and coercion in the interest of maintaining order, playing out the way that it does? What does it say about us? Okay. One could go on for a very long time about that. We don't have an essay in this volume about racial profiling. We don't have an essay in this volume about selective police enforcement of the anti-drug laws and so forth in the country. We couldn't have an essay about everything in the volume. But there is a huge and growing literature out there and a great deal of concern out there about not the explicit racism of the Bull Connors who says, oh, there's a black, let's go and arrest him, but the tacit racism that's embedded both within the fact that sometimes the disparity in the incidence of punishment by race is at least tacitly a reason for doing a policy. And sometimes we do the policy despite the fact that there's a huge racial disparity. Do you understand the distinction that I make here? Sometimes the face of the bad guy is the other, the enemy, the one that we're afraid of, is black in our subconscious. But sometimes the deleterious consequences that are concentrated by race simply don't register on our screen. It just simply doesn't motivate us to consider that we might change our policies and do things differently. I'll just close in saying that I've been very influenced by the writings of William Stuntz, the law professor at Harvard, who has observed that earlier in the 20th century, while one did have significant problems of crime and public safety, one seemed to have a greater degree of leniency and of equality in the application of punishment, particularly in the large American cities. Stuntz goes back to the early 20th century, the wave of immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe and so forth, and talks about the fact that prosecutors had less discretion, so you weren't resolving most of these cases by plea bargains. Police tended to live in the communities in which they were actually applying the law, so that there was a degree of maybe flexibility or ambiguity, or at least a complexity of understanding, and that voting majorities in the districts where the crime were taking place had a great deal more control over the institutions of the sustaining public safety. We have a kind of political agency problem, a separation between the locus of control over criminal justice policies and the local of interest. The people who live in the communities of high incidence of crime, yes, there are many offenders living there, and there are many victims living there. And there are many people who are both victims and offenders, and there are many families in which there are both victims and offenders. And the doing of justice in such an environment, the sorting out of just how hard do we want to come down on, quote unquote, the bad guys, and when do we want to give leniency, is facilitated, it seems to me, by the participation of people who are actually rooted in this ambiguous and conflict-ridden situation in the institutions that are administering justice. And that's not happening. not for the large majorities in the core of our cities where the problem resides and where the incidence of mass incarceration is most severe. Thanks.
Heartfelt thanks to